I'm just going to show you two slides on blood and blood component therapy. We know that we have, nowadays we have to avoid blood transfusion. Whenever we can avoid blood transfusion, we have to avoid blood transfusion. And if we need it, it's better to give us components rather than giving whole blood, because due to the whole range of reactions. What are the transfusion reactions? It can be broadly classified as hemolytic transfusion reactions, non-hemolytic transfusion reactions, infections, graft versus host disease, transfusion-related acute lung injury, what is called as TRALI, and immunomodulation. This TRALI is a very lately there are many cases have been reported from the Western world, also from India, a few cases. I made this presentation because recently I had a case, and for the first time in my life I knew that there is something called TRALI with blood transfusion. That is why I brought this case for this. TRALI is a transfusion related acute lung injury. We had a 27-year-old. I work in a hospital in South Africa, which is where we see around 150 to 200 patients every day. And we have an operation list of 5 to 6 patients every day, say in sections and other cases. And it's a 40 to 50 bedded hospital. And then we have all facilities, we do all sort of work, but we don't have ICU. So we had a 27-year-old multipurpose lady, had 2 normal deliveries, 2.5, 2.75. Antenatally, she was perfect, she never had any medical problems. She was admitted on 3rd of November at 10 a.m. and she had only a short duration of labor, 5 hours. On the other hand, at 2:40 p.m. on the same day, she was already dilated at full dilatation for 1 hour. Normally, we allow people to have a full dilatation for 1 hour. If there is no evidence that the head is coming down, we do a cesarean section. She had a cesarean section at 2:40 p.m. You know that it's a very short duration of labor. Baby came out crying, after 9, 10 and 3.1 kg. And this cesarean section was done by one of our resident professors, MD, who was a very senior person. Postoperatively, what happened is, for 3 hours, BP and pulse was around 100 by 60 and pulse rate was around 90, 92. Then they found that pulse rate is progressively increasing. Even though the blood pressure almost remained the same. Normally, whenever there is tachycardia, low blood pressure, we think in terms of postpartum hemorrhage. But in this particular woman, there was no bleeding for vagina. And so they waited. So what happened is, slowly this pulse rate is going from 90 to 130. Then the blood pressure started coming down to 80 by 60. That is the time she woke and she said, probably we have to open again and see. And then she called me, I went there. By the time I went there, the BP was 50 by 30 and pulse rate was around 140. We have ordered for 6 units of blood. And while we were operating, we had only 1 unit. This was a fated pre-Diwali night. Okay, 3 relatives went in 3 different directions to get blood. And they came after 4 hours. They said they couldn't reach. First of all, they went with great difficulty, got the blood. They couldn't reach the hospital for 2 hours. Something like this. After we finished the surgery, after 2 hours only we had the blood. Okay. At laparotomy, they were pumping bleeders from the left angle of the section. A large hematoma on the left broad ligament. There was also some bleeders from the posterior aspect of the uterus. Trying to research it was fruitless, and as the patient's condition further deteriorated, it was 50 by 30 with dopaminergic. Pulse rate was 140. Anesthetist was not very happy, and we were also not happy because we wanted to save the patient. So what I did is I did a hysterectomy. So being a multiparouth, the relatives, so immediately they gave consent, whoever is available. So I have done a obstetric hysterectomy. Okay. Then after that, all the blood arrived. So we gave 3 units of blood transfusion and the patient still continued to remain pale. The pulse rate again was 128 to 138. So we were thinking whether she has got again bleeding. But there was no bleeding we did the umbilical measurement and it was remaining same. There was no evidence of external bleeding or internal bleeding, but pulse state is always 130, 132. It was between 126 to 132. So we have given, again we thought probably subdivision, we gave 5 units of packed cells and also 3 units of fresh frozen plasma. She continued to remain pale, but she was conscious, she was alert. Urine output was okay. Partial pressure of oxygen between 85 to 100 with oxygen, just oxygen. Pulse rate again it was 130, 140, something like that. So this is all we have given totally. Patient continued to remain pale with tachycardia. So we observed her through the night and then morning we thought we cannot handle her anymore. So it is, she is better in an intensive care unit. So we transferred her to an intensive care unit of another hospital. In the intensive care unit, she was conscious, oriented, alert, careful, but dehydrated. 90/60 without support, without document support. Respiratory rate 36 per minute. Oxygen 90%. On 4th, that is next day, her hemoglobin was 6.2 grams. All the other investigations, it was platelets, 95,000, but basically other investigations were normal. Yes. Bilirubin was normal, only the plasma protein was 4 grams, albumin was 2.8. Next day, hemoglobin dropped to 4.9 grams, 3 units of packed cells they have given. So on the 3rd day, that is 4th, we operated. She developed dyspnea. Respiratory rate continued to be 40 per minute and just extensive repetitions. Albumin again is 2.2 on that day, and globulin 1.9, total serum protein is 4.1. Next. So the chest X-ray which was taken on 4th of November was fairly clear lung fields. Subject to comment from the Basari and the next. On the 6th of November, she had bilateral infiltrations, resinous opacity, both middle and lower zones. This was the X-ray which was taken on the 6th of November. So, comparison. So, blood cultures, Pseudomonas grown in 3 blood samples. So, the treatment was given is they didn't think that she needed mechanical ventilation because she was fairly stable. So they have given almost the ventilator. So she was given antibiotics, fluid to the steroids and parotids, not used for the steroids and diuretics. On 10th of November, hemoglobin was 8.5 grams. Protein was a little bit up. She was shifted out of ICU. She was discharged well from the hospital. 11 for us. So summarize, this is a mental participation, third segment section. Bleeding, muscular dystrophy, massive blood transfusion, hypoalbumin, pseudomonas septicemia, transfusion related hypertension. Next. What is TRAH here? This is a serious adverse event of blood transfusion. So it is defined as acute dyspnea with hypoxia and bilateral pulmonary infiltrates. Occurring during or within 24 hours of transfusion, but occasionally later also, with no other apparent cause other than the transfusion. TRAH is the third leading cause of transfusion-related mortality. It's very much underdiagnosed, very much underreported. It has been reported with all types of blood components, including whole blood, red cells, platelets, fresh frozen plasma. Sometimes, in some cases, they have even given 100 ml, 200 ml of blood. And immediately the patient had it. TRAH is most commonly seen and appears to be more severe with products containing large amount of plasma such as whole blood or fresh frozen plasma. That is why we try to give the red for the sense it's safe to remove the plasma as much as possible to remove the or dilute the antibodies. Characteristics the same. Only thing is there should be no other risk factors for acute lung injury. So she should not have any other medical problem like echocardiogenic or other problems. So transfusion patient is healthy and this is the only thing which has given. Yes. Differential diagnosis of respiratory insufficiency related to blood transfusion. Suppose I'm giving blood transfusion, patient becomes dyspneic, she has other problems. You have to think of all these things. Circulatory overload, contaminated blood, anaphylactic reactions, hemolytic transfusions, and falling. Mortality rate could be as high as 5 to 10%. Diagnosis of TALI is supported by clinical and radiographic evidence and not dependent on any lab. This is the same thing to somewhere else. Spalmary edema must first be seen as repeated areas, then afterwards you get a generalized edema. So classic TALI is therefore a clinical syndrome. Patients with classic TALI should not have other risk factors for acute lung injury. Transfusion is the only identifiable cause of this particular community disease. Pathophysiology and what is this due to? It is attributed to anti-HLA antibodies in the plasma of the lung. So what happens is, a lot of these multiparous women, they get this HLA sensitization from the previous pregnancies, and some of them they have got the HLA antibodies. So whenever we are giving blood transfusion from a woman, multiparous woman, the donor is a multiparous woman, then she can give HLA antibodies, but of course men also can give, but mostly it is from women donors. Also could be granulocyte antibodies. In some cases there are no antibody has been formed. They say that it is due to that membrane lipids which accumulate during blood storage. That is why when blood is stored for a long period of time, you have got an accumulation of biological response modifiers such as membrane lipids. It may be implicated in these cases. More rarely, cases have been described with donor antigen and recipient antibodies. That's what I was telling you. Because if it is a woman and she has got the antibodies, it can react to the antigens. So multiple female donors are more likely to possess anti-leukocyte antibodies. No particular patient risk factors have been identified to say that this woman will develop TALI, that woman will not develop TALI, or this person will develop. There is no particular thing which is identified. What is the pathogenesis? The donor antibodies act against the antigens. The antigen-antibody complex activates the complex with a certain neutrophil influx into the lungs. So there is a neutrophil activation in the lungs. The sequestrated neutrophils cause endothelial cell damage, capillary damage, capillary leakage, which contains large amount of albumin, and pulmonary damage. The treatment is, first step is arriving at a correct diagnosis, which is very, very difficult. Like this. We will know what we are dealing with in this particular case. Diagnosis, there are no specific laboratory tests available. Initial diagnosis depends on the high degree of suspicion. Lab findings may include unexpected tumor concentration because large amount of fluid gets sequestrated into the lung and also into the pleural cavity. This lady has also little amount of ascites. Pulmonary, if it examine the pulmonary exudate and TALI, you can find a high albumin protein. It's important to distinguish TALI from transfusion-associated circulatory overload. Because we won't know when we have given so much of blood. We don't know we are dealing with a case where we have given too much of blood or we have got TALI. So as the treatment of these two conditions is markedly different, because in that patient there is hemodilution, if it is circulatory overload, but in TALI because due to the diffusion of she has got a hemoconcentration. So treatment involves, so there is suspicion, immediate management of respiratory compromise in the patient by clinical team of experts. Simultaneously start transfusion reaction workup. So send everything, all the set and solutions to the laboratory in addition blood and post-transfusion urine specimens. Management is essentially supportive in this condition. Says that gentle ventilation, lung protective ventilation, mostly oxygen by mask is essential, but mechanical ventilation may be required in some cases, in severe cases, but normally it is not required, like this case. Diuretics are often prescribed because of an initial but mistaken diagnosis.